Good morning to everyone who called in.
Okay.
I am Phyllis Silver, the Director of the Partnership for Quality Care, and I am delighted this morning to welcome you to this collaboration between the National Quality Forum and the Partnership for Quality Care. The incredible numbers of people who have registered reinforce the interest in this series put together on affordability. I'm going to start with a few quick housekeeping points so that we can begin promptly. You will note that only the speaker has a mic. Everyone else on the webinar will be muted. You can write in comments, questions, submit them at any time during the webinar in the chat space at the bottom of your screen. We will have answers, question and answer session at the end of our presenters once they've completed their presentation. Then, once we finish written comments and questions, we will open all of the mics for any final comments, questions, to those for our audio only. So, with no further ado, at this point, it is my privilege and honor to turn over the mic to the Secretary for the Partnership for Quality Care, the CEO and Chairman of Kaiser Permanente, Bernard Tyson.
Hi, good morning, and it really is a great day, and I'm very excited about the agenda that we have for this morning, and really excited to be partnering with Chris Cassel in doing this together with you. Just a couple of opening comments, and then I'll turn it right over to Chris, and then we'll get right into the presentation. I think it's a wonderful statement by the attendees and by the National Quality Forum and the Partnership for Quality Care to really be on the side of accepting that healthcare in America is not as affordable as it should be for Americans and others who are still locked out in some cases of the healthcare system and or find themselves making life choices every day, every week, every month as to whether or not they will get a particular treatment or buy food in some cases for their families. I think that we are demonstrating that we don't plan to indict the wonderful men and women who work in the healthcare industry every single day saving lives and doing this tremendous work to making healthcare available and accessible and in many cases life-saving techniques that are deployed every day in saving lives around the country. But there's no question when you look at the system of healthcare and the industry that makes up the healthcare in this country and you see the scores, you see the results. You see a system that still has almost 50 million people not covered. And coverage is the front door key to the American healthcare system. I'm glad that we have decided collectively that we are really going to do something about it. And today is an example of that where people are coming together like-minded to look at possible solutions and proven solutions to really help this country get on the right track to making the healthcare system more affordable, more efficient, and more available to everyone. And so with that, I'm certainly excited to be a part of this and very pleased and honored to be co-hosting this morning's session. With that, let me turn it over to Dr. Chris Cassel.
Thank you, Bernard. I agree with you about the importance and excitement of this session this morning and sort of what it indicates about where we are in the framework of ensuring quality of care. If we include affordability as a key component of quality, then we need to find better ways to measure affordability and, frankly, to measure value for consumers and purchasers who are the ones who are actually paying for these services. So that said, one of the reasons that this event is so critical is that from the perspective of NQF, as I've looked around the country, there are very few really rigorous and well-tested cost and resource use measures that are available now. We've at NQF have had a couple of projects, some funded by CMS, some by Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, looking at this whole area of affordability and how do you even define it and then begin to measure it. So in that process, we've become aware that we really, this is a great shortage area for the nation in terms of measures that we can all use across the country to be able to understand better that we're adding value as we bend the cost curve. So there is, however, a beacon of light, which is the total cost of care measure that we are here this morning to talk about. It is one of the few NQF-endorsed cost measures and has been widely used. And here's my opportunity to put in a plug for the National Quality Forum. If you go to our homepage, just this month, we have a monthly refresh of the homepage, and this month we are talking about this issue of affordability, cost, and value. And there is a brief interview with Mary Brainerd from HealthPartners, the leader there, talking about the use of this measure. And as she puts it, that NQF endorsement of the measure has shown that it was rigorously tested and makes it industrial strength, which means that it really contributes to its ability to be used more broadly. And actually, now it is currently used in at least 29 states that we're familiar with. So I think it's a real success story of the value of local innovation in how we use data to develop quality metrics, and then being able to spread that innovation for benefit throughout the country. So I'm grateful to Health Partners and to our colleagues in Minnesota for that work, and look forward to being with you through the rest of the hour.
I'm going to turn this over at this point and introduce our two speakers this morning. It's Beth Averbeck, who's the Associate Medical Director of Primary Care at Health Partners Medical Group. And Beth is a practicing internist in geriatrics. She's responsible for clinical quality governance and operations for the primary care practice at Health Partners. Through her work and leadership in redesigning ambulatory care, Health Partners has twice been awarded the American Medical Group Association Acclaim Award, recognizing innovation in healthcare. Our other presenter, also from Health Partners, is Kim Ritten, Manager of Consumer and Trends Analytics and the Health Informatics part of Health Partners. She project managed the total cost of care and total resource use measures through the National Quality Forum consensus development process, which has led to the endorsement by the NQF in 2012. Currently, Kim is responsible for consumer quality and cost transparency, as well as healthcare trend analyses. Beth and Kim, can I turn this over to you?
Yes, thank you so much. And we just want to say thank you for inviting us to speak. We're thrilled to have the opportunity to present our work, and not only the development of the measure and obviously the importance of the NQF endorsement, but also give some examples of the use of measure to improve the care that we are providing within the medical group and across the community. So we thought we would start with just a quote when we're talking about setting the context, which seems pretty fitting for an era of evolving payment reform where we're trying new things, learning quickly that there's not a single approach that aligns incentives across many specialties and stakeholders. And so we continue to evolve, we continue to use the measure in different ways, and we thought this quote was fitting to get us started. Just to give you some background on Health Partners, we are integrated care delivery and financing organization. We are consumer governed and nonprofit. we have, between the medical group, the health plan, our foundations, around 22,000 employees or team members. And in our market, most of the payment here is value-based payment, and so it's a combination of fee-for-service, performance metrics, and cost savings or some total cost of care contracting. And so from the health plan side, 85% of the members that are insured by our health plan are in some type of value-based contracting with the medical groups. And then for our medical group, all of our contracting has some value-based payments. And within the Twin Cities, about a third of the health partners' insured members get their care within the medical group. And for the medical group, about half of our patients come from our health plan and half come from others. So we're very matrixed in the community. So we do have a lot of collaboration across plans, across medical groups, and you'll get an example of that as we go through this. So here's what we'll cover today, the background of the importance of total cost of care, the measurement overview, and then give some case examples of how we've used the total cost of care metrics within our medical group. And to get us started, we reference the triple aim, and we remain committed to the Institute for Healthcare Improvement's triple aim to set our goals, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with this. And while there have been many standard measures of quality and experience, that's not been the case with affordability as introduced earlier. And so we've done some work to close that gap, and that's what we'll be sharing today. And this is one of the reasons that total cost of care is important when we take a look at what challenges we have in healthcare. If you look at the drivers of health, the 20%, and this is off of David Kindig's research at the University of Wisconsin, the 20% is related to medical services or the care that we provide within the medical system, 30% health behaviors, and then 40% socioeconomic factors, things like non-tobacco use in the environment, et cetera. But then when we look at where the money is spent, 88% of the spend right now is on medical services, and that's only making up 20% of the driver of health care. And so we take a look at this and say, how can we start to better allocate the resources and match them to where the drivers of health may be? And we think we've got a unique point of view, given that we have both care delivery and financing. And back when we started developing the measure, I was fortunate enough to be able to be a practicing clinician sitting with our informatics team looking at how we design measures that reflect total cost of care, both price and resource. And so we've had a very supportive partnership throughout, and we get data that's actionable. Working together, we could develop data that was then being able to be used. And then also, data is one thing, but you can either admire the data or do something with the data. And so what are the processes that we can have partnership both within the medical group but also with other medical groups and with other plans to then use the data for improvement? And then also, again, very complementary health management. And with that, I'll turn it over to Kim to give more background on the measure.
Great, thanks. So this is total cost of care at its simplest. Total cost of care measures allowed payments, inclusive of those made by the plan and by the member. And it's a combination of factors: resource use and price. Total resource use is the number and types of services used. And we have a patented approach, which is available free of charge at our website, to measure the frequency and intensity of all healthcare services for a population. The other factor is price. And price is influenced by not only the fee schedule, but by healthcare choices made by the patient and provider. It includes pure cost of a specific service as determined by a fee schedule, the effects of where providers refer their patients, and the impact of a specific hospital or specialist fee schedule. And it includes the place of service choices. For example, whether an MRI is performed in a hospital outpatient setting or in a freestanding imaging center. So a little bit more about the details. Total cost of care starts at the population level. It measures a care group or ACO's performance, though we use an attribution model to anchor the relationship with primary care visits. The model is person-centered, which means it includes all care for a patient, including inpatient, outpatient, professional, and pharmacy services. It is a relative reporting system where performance is indexed as above or below average. This means that adjusting for variable illness burden is necessary for apples-to-apples comparisons, and we use the Johns Hopkins Adjusted Clinical Group software for that. The information is drillable to conditions and episodes of care, and our unique companion measure, resource use, which is also endorsed by the NQF, enables isolation of practice opportunities versus price opportunities. So Health Partners measures have been stress tested through over 15 years of practical use in our market, but they were also, as mentioned, formally endorsed through the year-long review by NQF, by the NQF Steering Committee, which included a statistician's review. Our testing proved that these measures produce results that are both reliable and valid. This ensures that the measures are useful, precise, and that they measure cost and resources as intended. We publish all of our methods and the results of our reliability and validity testing on our website, which is healthpartners.com/PCOC. We'll show that again at the end. So as Dr. Cassel mentioned, in terms of use since the endorsement in 2012, we've seen uptake by more than 90 licensees across 29 states. That includes 5 statewide organizations. And we've seen a broad range of organizations using and learning about our methodology. And as a side note, a lot of the consulting firms, as you see as one of the larger buckets, actually are groups who are working with community collaboratives as well as organizations such as ACOs and other provider groups. So here's where we segue into how we use the measures at Health Partners. We have 4 main uses, and the first is benefit design from the plan, health plan perspective. You can see we evaluate value by looking at total cost of care in addition to quality. And quality includes both patient experience and clinical quality. And we have 2 bars a provider must pass to be in preferential networks or tiers for benefits. And they must be better than quality, better on quality than average, and better on cost than average. The second use is transparency, which in our minds goes hand in hand with benefit design. Members and patients need the information to make informed choices about based on cost and quality. All this information drills to more details that are available on the web. For example, total cost of care starts at the population level, but our framework allows drilling to conditions or procedures of interest, and we complement this information with service-specific price transparency, which is becoming increasingly important as consumers are paying greater out-of-pocket expenses. The third use is payment reform. This is a reflection of our journey and helps give context for why and how we have had these measures in use for over 15 years. While this looks like a long timeline, much of the journey was eaten up by the measure development cycle. As an integrated finance and care delivery system, as Beth mentioned earlier, we are in a unique position to design, test, and refine the system to get to an approach that could be scaled. The upshot of this journey is to move provider payment to one of rewarding quality over quantity. And as we introduce the first generation of total cost of care payment model, providers operate within a fee-for-service model with a portion of at-risk through shared savings. Incentive payments are set up for providers to reduce overall costs while at the same time maintaining or improving health and patient experience. As clinic systems mature, we shift the focus away from a fee-for-service payment model and toward a total cost of care and trend management model. We've also gained momentum in the areas of condition and episode-based bundles, payments, always with an eye on aligning incentives and impacting overall total cost of care. And it's taken us several years, but it doesn't need to take others so long because all the information to build the case and the tools are available today. The fourth use is provider improvement. And just like we support members and patients with transparent cost information at multiple levels, we support the providers with multiple levels of information and engagement to understand performance and improve. On a quarterly basis, we generate a standard reporting package and data suite for providers to identify improvement areas and take action. And we support provider groups individually with health plan medical directors and the informatics team to help understand the reports and the drivers of their total cost of care. We also create custom analytics to meet providers' specific process improvement needs. The quarterly reporting package includes 3 views of information that make it highly usable. The first is a financial view, which is used for contract management. The second is a benchmarking view that helps to understand the practice performance compared to others in the market. And finally, the patient-level data feed includes important information to augment the EHR and to help to proactively coordinate care. It includes predictive risk information and information about the use of hospital services and medications. So this is an example of the care improvement project portfolio for our own care group. It reflects many of the same areas we see our contracted partners focus on as well. At this point, I'm going to hand the presentation back over to my colleague, Dr. Averbeck, to discuss how the information is used in practice. This gives a general overview if we're going to take a look at where the opportunities that we have within the medical group to make improvements. I'm sure as you look at this, you'll see that you probably have opportunities in these areas as well. But care improvements are about doing more of the things that are evidence-based and thereby decreasing some of the utilization and in some cases the pricing as well. So we want to increase healthy lifestyles, coordinate care more effectively for our patients, appropriate use of services, and then engaging patients in decisions, and that could either be shared decision-making or patient activation as well in self-management, and then evidence-based care. Just to give you an overview, this is a copy of the data that a medical group, ours, would receive, other medical groups as well, and the purpose of the slide is to show you the wealth of data that we get, and then we get different drill-down metrics as well. And this is a benchmarking view, and it would show a provider's overall relative position on illness burden, total cost of care, and then also resource use and price. It'll also include risk-adjusted utilization rate, place of service information to understand drivers of performance, and then in addition to benchmarking information, there's plenty of drill-down information at the condition and episode level, as well as prescribing and referral provider profiles. And there's also data files containing patient-level information that's available to physicians as well, and that can help with care coordination and improvement efforts. I'm going to walk you through how we might use this data, or how we do use the data, and just give you some examples. This would be our first overview, and if we take a look here, the metro average would be 1, and the provider group we're looking at would be the top bar. And so we've got a total cost index of 1.01. If we divide that between price and then resource, we can see the price is about the metro average, but the resource use is a little bit higher. So the options for improving would be either to lower price or to then take a look at where the resource use might be. If we go down to some of the resource use then, under this same example, this provider group has a higher acuity, and again, the metrics are already take that acuity into consideration as far as the benchmarking. And if we follow it through, it looks on this group that there's a little bit less use of primary care, a little bit more use of specialty. Now, that doesn't tell us whether that's appropriate or a potential opportunity. It just tells us that it might be an area to look further. Lab and pathology here would be 7 points above the metro, so that would be another area to look at. Again, it doesn't say whether that's right or wrong. It just says we're higher, so let's take a look at that. And then if we look at some of the higher cost utilization measures in this example, the ER use is actually below the benchmark, so we're doing well in ER use, but high-tech radiology would be higher. And so looking at this from a medical group standpoint, we would probably then go to lab and pathology and take a look at high-tech diagnostic imaging and see where those opportunities might be. We then can get a condition-focused example, and we'll walk through some examples here on both back pain and diabetes, which is why we have them highlighted. So you can take a look at the utilization metrics and take a look at the condition metrics and see where is there a match. So in this example for back pain, we know previously we were higher on the high-tech diagnostic imaging, and if we look at back pain, we can see the same thing here. We're about the same on price in this example. The resource use or utilization is higher, and matching that with the high-tech diagnostic imaging would then tell us this is a place to look to say how are we managing back pain and do we have any opportunity there. And then diabetes as well, we could take a look at total cost index here and look at resource use. An example here might be for higher in lab and use. Are we ordering A1Cs more often than we need to? Are we ordering LDLs more often than we need to? Just to give you an example of the things we might look into further. Just wanted to walk you through some work that we've been doing around uncomplicated back pain. And according to the Journal of the American Medical Association, about 80% of adults will suffer from back pain at some point in their lifetime. And patients who suffer from back pain need an average of $6,000 worth of medical care each year. And this could be either through looking at imaging, it could be looking at loss of work as well. And so we had a system where patients who get back pain obviously are in pain, they're concerned, they end up with sometimes having fear of what kind of function they might have. There may be some psychosocial factors as well, deconditioning, medication use, and then if we don't appropriately treat it, we can end up with having dependency on the healthcare system. So we've taken a look at how we would approach uncomplicated back pain.
And what we've done within our medical group and within our plan is got together key stakeholders across primary care, specialty care, ancillary services, and then use a standardized tool approach and standardized patient messaging and metrics, we're able to take a look at how we're providing care for back pain. And the way the pathway works is a patient can come into either primary care, in some cases chiropractic, for back pain, and we've recommended active physical therapy. So we've partnered preferentially with a couple of physical therapy groups in town. They're not owned by us, but they're preferred relationships, where the physical therapy groups have agreed to do active physical therapy with the goal of improving function. And so we'll preferentially refer to those physical therapy groups. And in some cases, in some of our clinics, we have a blended model of chiropractic and primary care, and within that model, we can do same-day referrals, either from chiro to primary or primary to chiropractic care. Most patients will get better with that, and we give them patient messaging around increasing physical activity, avoiding opioid use, avoiding imaging if there are no red flags. And most patients will get better with this approach. For those that don't, we have a medical spine specialist that's a non-surgical specialist for us that's usually in the area of PM&R, physical medicine and rehab, or neurology, in some cases occupational medicine, but then that's the second referral, medical referral. And that person will then take a look and either make recommendations around sometimes medication management, potentially injections, potentially surgical or referral. And with that pathway, we've been doing this over the last year, and I can say I've had personally two relatives that have been in that pathway and have both had good outcomes. So from a patient experience standpoint, I can give you a personal recommendation on that. When we take a look at the affordability results with that pathway, which was really about improving the care, we also see that we're also decreasing the cost. And we're seeing a decrease in lumbar fusions, a decrease in overall lumbar surgeries. We've seen fewer prescriptions for opioids written, lower use of high-tech diagnostic imaging, lower use of emergency rooms. So adding up, this is close to $2 million of savings in 1 year. I wanted to switch over to using a chronic care example, and that of diabetes care. And in our market, we've been using transparency around optimal diabetes. This is also a measure that's been NQF endorsed as well. But taking a look at an all or none measure of blood pressure under control, LDL up until recently under 100, and obviously that's in a state of discussion right now with the revised guidelines. Blood sugar control, non-smoker, and then aspirin use if cardiovascular disease is present. And in order to achieve these results for our patients, we look at how do we use teamwork, using all members of the care team to their maximum ability. And some examples would be, we have shared visits where an RN might start a visit with the patient, do more patient engagement, more patient education, health coaching around medication adherence or physical activity, healthy lifestyle, et cetera. We have a registry that we use that our LPNs will then proactively identify patients that either need follow-up or maybe had a medication change and will proactively outreach to see how they're doing. We're trying to offer more affordable ways of accessing the healthcare system, and so we use e-visits, we use scheduled telephone visits. The average savings per visit is around $88 for using either an e-visit or a telehealth visit. And for patients that have high deductible plans, it may actually be cheaper for them to pay for an e-visit or a phone visit than to come in for an office visit. So again, using patient choice, we are offering different avenues of accessing their healthcare providers. And then also engaging patients in healthy lifestyle choices. And having gone to medical school, well-trained in telling patients what to do, trying to flip the conversation to asking patients what they're interested in doing and then supporting them in reaching those goals. And so we've had a health coaching approach, and all of our RNs have been trained in health coaching, as have our diabetes educators, our pharmacists, our nutritionists, and we're branching that out now to our physicians and other members of the care team. When we started this measure transparently, even before 2004, but this is about the time that we went on our electronic health record and could get the data from our health record instead of having it be claims or chart review. And when we started, we were at about 4% for all measures being met, and now we've been stable at around 47% for the last year. And these are the, again, all or none measures, so it's taking a look at managing cardiovascular risk. And what we're seeing for the results for the patients then is we're seeing a lower incidence of adverse outcomes. So decreasing the incidence of acute heart attacks or strokes, amputations, and retinopathy. And this is what's most meaningful for our patients. And if we do this annually, this is what we would say from the standpoint of a population view. Annually, we're saving 417 hearts, 72 limbs, 745 pairs of eyes. And we also estimate for that for the savings per patient who's optimally managed is around $1,500 per patient per year, meeting all the cardiovascular risk management for their diabetes. We also have been focusing on generic drug prescribing rates, and over time we can see that we've increased the percent generic prescribing. This is both medical group and then also in our market, other medical groups have been increasing generic prescribing as well. But we know that on average, for us, 1% improvement in generic prescribing saves about $1 million in cost for the patients that we serve. From a patient standpoint, if the average difference between a branded and a generic prescription is $15 to $30, a patient taking four monthly prescriptions could save anywhere out-of-pocket costs between $720 and $1,440 per year. So it's not only saving it from the standpoint of the medical group, but on an individual patient, it's less out-of-pocket costs for them as well. So those are examples of more condition-specific, but as we know, most patients don't have just one condition. A lot of patients will have four to five different conditions. And so if we take an overall view of doing care coordination, we would take a look at combining all of these different conditions and how could we improve care coordination. And our approach to looking at care coordination is if we take a look at the distribution of the population, we know that the top 1% for those complex chronic needs use about 29% of total healthcare spend. And then following that pyramid, 70% of the population that's healthy using about 11% of overall healthcare spend. And so what we've done is taken a look at what are the support that 1% needs and trying to match resources with the patient need, because not all patients need the same amount of resources, but that top 1% needs obviously more resources, and so that's our focus over the last year to two. And these just give you some ideas of how we're doing that. Working with our own informatics team, we're identifying those most at risk either through a claims or we've done the same analytics through our electronic health record to identify those high risk. Our hospitals have another algorithm that they use, and we sat back once and said, well, should we all have one great big algorithm we all use? And we say, no, there are different ways of identifying them. And on a Venn diagram, a lot of them overlap, but each method might identify patients that the other one doesn't. And so we use all those methods to kind of give us a funnel of patients that need more support. And then we do proactive outreach to those patients, develop care plans that are shared across the medical group and disease and case management with our own health plan. Looking at shared visits again with the RN starting a visit and the physician coming in and then the RN completing the visit. Looking at mental health needs, because a lot of these patients that have complex needs also have mental health needs as well. And then linking to existing resources instead of recreating all of our resources. So when we take a look at the resource needs, we will ask, does it need to be local, could it be regional, or could it be a central resource? And that's how we've approached this. Just to give you some examples of what we've done, we've worked with our specialty care partners to do a standardized referral template. When we went to our electronic health record, we had 35 specialties with 35 different referral templates, and kind of did a timeout to say, okay, this is just causing rework, and how could we make it simpler? And then also, specialty assumed accountability. Instead of us just giving patients a phone number and saying, call your specialty and schedule, we knew 30% of patients did not schedule. And so specialty will take that order and they'll contact the patients generally within 24 hours to get an appointment set up. And then more recently we developed a hotline. We said it wasn't a good use of physician time to be negotiating access over the phone. And so if we have a complicated patient where we don't know if they need some intervention that day, each specialty has agreed to have a hotline that's picked up by a person, and then they'll get us a specialist to answer the question. And this is obviously for more urgent or emergent questions. But then we can have a care plan for that patient, either whether they need to be seen that day or whether we can start doing a treatment plan that day. And it's a better experience for our patients as well, because obviously if it's an urgent need, they want to have their plan before they leave the office. We also know for urgent care and ED, sometimes patients will access them and may or may not have established with the primary care physician. And so our urgent care and our emergency department can place orders into primary, and that's worked by a central call bank. And they'll contact the patient and invite them to come and establish care. We do get a list from our own hospital, but also from community hospitals that are outside of our system of patients that have been seen in the emergency department. And then our RNs are giving them a call to find out, do they need to be seen? Are they, and if, or could they have come to the clinic or urgent care instead of the ED, and in that case, doing some education about some options next time. And then hospital to, or home to hospital, the primary physician is notified of the admission. We have a hospitalist system for the most part in the Twin Cities. But sometimes a primary care physician has added information, and when they know the patient's been hospitalized, they can contact the hospitalist and provide that. And then also a hospital to home, and then once we had done that, we extended that to TCU. We have over 3,500 patients in TCU and long-term care in the Twin Cities, and we know those are vulnerable times for either for admissions or readmissions, and so we have a set of nurses that will call those patients after they've gone back home and make sure that they're taking their medications, that they have follow-up, answer any questions. And we are starting to see some improvements. And is it one thing? No, it's probably a bunch of things that we've done that are resulting in these reductions in readmissions, and this has been over the last few years. We're also seeing a reduction in admissions, and then we take a look at the average cost of admission per day is $2,000. By decreasing the admissions, that's obviously helping us with our total cost of care as well, and we see the same trend line for emergency department use too. I wanted to talk to you or introduce to you an ACO model that our medical group and our plan is participating in along with another medical group in the Twin Cities. In one part of the Twin Cities, our health plan is a major insurer there, and most of the patients that are insured by the health plan are taken care of either by our medical group or by another medical group. And so the two medical groups along with our health plan have come together in what we're calling the Northwest Metro Alliance, and Northwest is only because that's a part of the Twin Cities that we're covering. And we're using our total cost of care and our quality data combined. And we knew even within our own medical group on a total cost of care data, this part of the Twin Cities, our clinics were higher in total cost of care than clinics in our own medical group in other parts of the city. So we had opportunity within our own clinics as well as opportunity across that community. And we lead with clinical focus and patient experience and then follow with affordability. And these are just some of the areas based on where we identified opportunity, not using antibiotics for uncomplicated bronchitis, looking at generic prescribing. The clinics that we had in our medical group were lower than our other clinics, and the clinics in the other medical group had opportunity. And then, as we mentioned earlier, the low back pain. We had a higher use of high-tech diagnostic imaging in that part of the Twin Cities. And so these were our clinical focus areas. And then hospital focused on readmissions, mental health follow-up, and then safe and effective inductions of labor. And we had a project manager that worked with both organizations, and we had a steering committee that had health plan and then leadership from both organizations that meets and continues to meet. And this is our 2012 triple aim highlights. We're still waiting for the 2013 data to come in. But you can see that combined, and these are for the whole Metro Alliance, not our medical group or the other medical group, but both of us combined, improved generic prescribing from 75% to 87%. Elective labor inductions less than 39 weeks went from 8% to 0. We decreased admissions from 12% above the metro average to 6% above the metro average. So we still have opportunity, but we're seeing the trend line going in the right direction. Improved colon cancer screening rates, improved satisfaction within the hospital for the newborn area. And then we implemented diagnostic imaging decision support within the electronic health record so that the patient and the physician could see what type of tests were recommended or no tests recommended for particular conditions. And with this, this is a trend line here for our total cost of care. When we started this work, we were about 8% on trend, and now we've been lower than the community on trend over the last couple of years. So we are seeing not only the improved clinical results, but then also the results on the total cost of care. And so we thought we'd finish by using a quote from Don Berwick, because I mean, I sit and I work with the medical group, and we say, geez, if we could only do two things, wouldn't that be great? So we could just prioritize. And I think in order to improve the triple aim and health experience and improve affordability, this quote is very fitting, which is the only way we can do it is to do not one thing, but everything. And so with that, this is our healthpartners.com total cost of care website that has more information if you're interested. And we will close our part of the presentation and then take some questions. And we did have a couple of questions that were sent in ahead of time, so we thought we'd start with those. While any of you have other questions, please feel free to send them in. And our first question was, what tools are available today to help patients understand and calculate the total cost of care? And what tools are available to help people compare the affordability of various health plan options? And Kim's going to answer this one.
Yeah, thanks. So I think, as we mentioned in our presentation, at least within Health Partners, we make a lot of tools available to our consumers, to our members and patients. And we have several tools, as we mentioned, about service-specific price transparency. We also have some tools as members are looking at which plan might be the right plan for them. It's something called Plan For Me, where they can enter their own information, their own health information. It helps them decide, you know, if they have different various plan options, what might be the best fit for them. And then externally, I think there's a range of things that are, I think, becoming more available. I think as different areas of the country become more comfortable with transparency, I think in our market in particular, we've had transparency for quite some time through the plans, as well as through Minnesota Community Measurement that has today available average cost for procedure information available, and coming soon, total cost of care information. We're also seeing the Network for Regional Healthcare Improvement, NRE, has a grant from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation working with community collaboratives across the country in Oregon, Minnesota, Maine, Colorado, and Missouri to bring measures like this to the communities and be transparent on cost of care. So, and specifically on the health plan options, I think right now, at least we see probably through the Affordable Care Act, some of the exchanges may be some of the best places to look at the various health plan options, but I'm sure this is just, I think transparency is just really in its infancy, and we'll probably see that continue to grow nationwide. And this is Beth. I think what I might add to that too is when we talk about the tools, it's tools for patients, but sometimes it's tools for our physicians and providers too. And we have done some work around looking at our lab utilization, both on price and utilization, and incorporated within the electronic health record an ability for our physicians to see our charges for each of the lab tests if they are interested, but also if the patient's in the exam room wants to know if they're on a high deductible, what a cost of a test might be. With a click, we can get that to our patients. So again, it's having everybody be more aware of the costs, and just some examples there. All right, our second question is, what is the role of transparency of cost to patients for decisions about treatments with high cost, such as cancer treatments? And I think a couple of answers here. Within the plan website, there are ability for people to see based on their own benefits what a cost of a test might be between different groups. And in fact, in Minnesota Community Measurement, there's an average cost per procedure for about 100 types of common procedures that range from labs to diagnostic imaging to colonoscopy to office visits. And that just gives people an idea. Certainly the total cost of care would give an overview. More specifically around cancer, looking at using health plan member services around benefit design. But then also within medical groups, taking a look at how do we improve the reliability of the pathways for those that are diagnosed with cancer. And we've done some work internally around a lung cancer pathway
where specialty oncology, pulmonary, primary, radiology, and cardiothoracic surgery are all on the same page, and there's a pathway for patients that are diagnosed with lung cancer that also provides a navigator for the patient. And so looking at how we provide that reliability to then make sure that we are being as cost effective as possible. Okay, our next question, are there any existing models in the world of a healthcare system that's affordable, and could the U.S. adopt that model? I think you had referenced back to the determinants of health and taking a look at what are not only the medical determinants but the social determinants, and through collaboratives that exist, we can learn from each other both within the states, because sometimes somebody in your own community is doing something really well, and then also through some of the national, international organizations, we have an opportunity to learn from each other. And then I think our last question here that we had sent in before was, are there innovative decision-making to create process change? And when we think about affordability, a lot of times people think about decreasing staff, and are there other ways to decrease costs by using innovative design thinking? And hopefully the presentation gave you some ideas of where we looked at decreasing costs without changing any of the staffing models. And I know our medical group here, a number of medical groups in town, and I certainly know medical groups across the country are looking at how we do care team models that effectively use the skills of every member of the care team. And so instead of decreasing staff, a lot of times it's having that same existing staff do different things that involve them more in taking care of those patients and those relationships with their patients.
I just wanted to make one other comment that I didn't mention earlier, but I also wanted to publicly acknowledge the vital role played in coming to this conversation today. By Jeffrey Sachs and the Sachs Policy Group. We would not have been able to bring this to fruition without their support and assistance here. I'd also like to thank Shannon Kelly for the work that she's done in putting this together. Let me turn, while we wait for anybody to write in some comments or questions in your chat box, let me ask if Bernard Tyson or Chris Cassel has any closing comments.
Cassel, I really appreciated the wonderful overview of some tremendously complex material. I think people who were following this, who are thinking about adopting measure use or developing measures, can really understand the complexity of the technical testing and statistical modeling that has to take place for a measure to have the really very positive value characteristics that this particular measure does. So I want to particularly acknowledge the importance of being able to look at specific conditions such as back pain and diabetes, but also to look at coordination of care, because that is something, particularly in an aging population, where I think we increasingly need more and more attention. So this group, the fact that we call this a single cost, a cost of care measure, suggests that it measures one thing, but in fact it measures many, many things, which is part of why it's so valuable. So kudos to you, and also, of course, to making it so widely available.
Thank you. And this is Beth. It does look like we did get one question on the role of the lung cancer oncology navigator, and a question as to whether it was a specialty RN. And yes, it is a specialty RN, and the role of that navigator is to help the patient with the next steps, self-management, and in some cases, some of the shared decision-making.
Hi, this is Bernard. Yeah, I just want to second what Chris Cassel said, and first also to thank Beth and Kim for just an outstanding presentation of this. I also think that this is a great example of a systematic approach and really great work, very thoughtful work. There is no black and white answer. There is no silver bullet. there's an exploration to figure out, how do we look at, measure, make decisions around total cost of care that leads to value, that leads to affordability. And I think that this was a great example of a fantastic organization that's on that path. And so I just wanted to thank them as well for being a part of this this conference.
Thank you. Thank you, Chris, and thank you, Bernard, Beth, and Kim. Thank you as well. I want everybody to know that the webinar will be available on the Partnership for Quality Care website. We're going to be sending out a survey of each of you who have registered to ask your advice about our future webinar in this affordability series. So for today, on behalf of the National Quality Forum and Partnership for Quality Care, I thank you all for really wonderful presentations and participation.